broadcast for shooters, hunters, and gun enthusiasts. This is the Firearms Radio Network. The bandwidth for this episode of the AR-15 podcast is sponsored by Patriot Patch Company, patriotpatch.co.
Welcome to the AR-15 podcast. This is the podcast about your favorite black rifle. This show is for you. Whether you're building your first AR or you've been building ARs for years, there is something we can all do to take our black rifle to the next level.
You make this show possible by clicking through our Brownells and Amazon affiliate links. The next time you order online, go to AR15podcast.com and click through our Brownells and Amazon affiliate links. It doesn't cost you anything extra, and a small portion of your sale goes to supporting pro-gun radio like the AR-15 podcast.
Well, hello, folks. Welcome to episode number 160 of the AR-15 podcast. We're glad to have you back. 160 episodes. Jeez. JD, I just keep looking at that number, and it staggers the imagination. So tonight, on this episode, we're going to talk about my long overdue day at the range and some thoughts on my old favorite standby, backup iron sights.
Before we go any further, I'd like to say parental advisory is advised. Could get a little graphic. Read in the iron sights. The candles may come out. The Barry White may come on. There may be a couple glasses of wine. So just warning you guys right now, could get interesting.
Now, I don't think that's quite as bad as all that. Hey, before we get started, let's touch on a couple of housekeeping items. I know that the transition to our new email was rather sudden and abrupt, and so I want to remind everybody that our feedback email address is ar15.podcast@gmail.com. ar15.podcast@gmail.com. So send us your emails and questions and anything that you want to touch base with us about to that address, and we'll be there to monitor it. And on another note, we've been having some iTunes difficulties. I think I know what it is, JD.
What's that?
Jake sorted out how to get all of our episodes on our iTunes page going back to number 11. And I think that somehow in accomplishing that goal, something messed up the feed. I don't know what, but I think that, haven't you been helping the listeners kind of sort that out, JD?
Yeah, we've been working on it. I thought it was because we were against, you know, the government making Apple open the back door thing, but maybe that was it. That's probably a more reasonable, less tinfoil hat explanation. But we did post something. Jake put together kind of a tutorial to help you get around it, to figure out what's going on with the iTunes. It's a iOS problem, and it's caused some just random podcasts. This Week in Guns and a couple other ones, people are seeing a random ability to not be able to download those podcasts. There are a couple other apps that you can check out that you'd be able to catch the AR-15 podcast on and the other podcasts on the Firearms Radio Network. You can check those out. Downcast, Pocket Cast are two that Jake recommends, and I've checked them both out. Pretty solid. So if your iTunes is giving you problems, go ahead and check out Pocket Cast and Downcast, and you'll be able to find the AR-15 podcast there just by searching. So hopefully Apple, when they're done fighting other battles, they can get this app problem taken care of.
Well, and you know, I think it probably makes sense to point out that if you go to www.ar15podcast.com, you can, I believe, still download an MP3 of the podcast every week. And I know that my iTunes will integrate any MP3 that I put in the special iTunes folder. into the media selections. And so it should be able to put it onto your Apple device if that's your device of choice. But even so, whatever you use, you should be able to put an MP3 on it. So that's always an option, right?
Yeah, with all the updates that Jake's doing to improve the Firearms Radio Network, AR15podcast.com will take you to the new Firearms Radio Network page, and you can see all the episodes there. But right there on the top, you can click on the AR15 podcast. It'll give you the latest episode, and it'll take you to kind of our sub page there that we have that you can download and check out the latest episode.
All right. So, folks, bear with us. We're doing our best to get these hiccups unraveled. Of course, I've been up to a little bit of a range time this last week and had a good opportunity to go out and basically get a bunch of the rifles that I have out and loaded up and put a few through their paces and got a chance to get some new shooters on them and some more experienced shooters on them to kind of proof them out and see if we had any hiccups. And I just had a great time. It was a wonderful experience, but that's kind of what I've been up to this this last week. JD, what have you guys been up to?
I've been shooting out some emails, trying to get some guests lined up. Also, we've got pretty exciting news about a giveaway that we will be doing. I don't want to give the whole cat out of the bag yet, but working with one of the gun shops we're quite familiar with and good guys, and something along the caliber of a pistol would probably be the hint that I can give without giving it all away. But something that you guys have been asking for and something that they have been able to make come true, and we'll be able to hopefully give that away and let that cat out of the bag here in the next couple of weeks. It's going to be an exciting 2016, and the first giveaway is going to be pretty cool.
All right. Sounds like a plan. Well, so I know that we kind of led off in our introduction with the idea of talking about a range, but, you know, I thought I'd go ahead and just interject with some iron sights information and just kind of revisit some of the things that we've talked about in past shows and just kind of lay it out there. You know, the sheer number of manufacturers who have iron sights in their inventory, you know, is pretty staggering. And, you know, I think that for the most part, they're all good quality systems. But, you know, when you can spend upwards of $100, you know, per end of the rifle, you know, $200 for a set, not everybody can amass and put hands on a large number of them. So I wanted to kind of collectively go over what we've assembled here in terms of iron sights that we've gotten some hands on, and just kind of go through them and give you some basic recommendations, let you know that we've had some really good success with these, and kind of illustrate some of the things that make them either innovative or quality buys or something that would compel you to go out and spend money on them. So, and then I think we can touch on some of the other routinely coupled topics that go along with an iron sights discussion. But let's just kind of get started and look at some of the offerings and some of the manufacturers that are out there. So when you think of backup irons, who immediately comes to mind, JD?
Magpul for me comes to mind immediately. It seems like they're generally the name that you see out there, or the name you hear when somebody's talking about their backup sights.
Well, you know, I think that's a good point. It is typically the manufacturer that I hear of when I see a discussion about backup irons, and you know, I don't even know where the abbreviation BUIS came from, but maybe it wasn't Magpul, but I've always seen it associated with the MBUS optics sights. So I think it all started with the first generation of MBUS sights, and you know, they were a polymer sight, and I think they really did kind of fit into a cost-effective vein, a cost-effective niche of the market, and answer the question that was asked, which is, where can I get a good quality optic sight that isn't going to, or I mean, backup iron sight that isn't going to break the bank? And so I think that was the answer that they came up with. Now, of course, the Gen 2 is what is out now, and I think they made some changes to the profile and maybe the mechanism that locked it down or released it. I think overall, there wasn't much in the way of a change that fundamentally changed the way the optic worked. I do believe there were some changes to the reticle. I could be wrong, but it has been a while since the Gen 2 came out. And frankly, at this point, I don't think you could get a Gen 1 if you tried, because my guess is that anything that said Gen 1 on eBay or the internet is probably knockoff, you know, Chinese crap. I just don't know that you're going to find anything that is anybody in anybody's inventory that is a legitimate Gen 1 Magpul backup iron.
Mm-hmm.
And then Magpul came out with something that was really stellar about, what was it, 2 years ago? About 2 years ago, I think it was. And that was the MBUS Pro, which is basically, you know, taking their polymer backup sight and actually turning it into a backup iron sight, because the MBUS Pro was a, I think it was a powder-coated metal. And I'm not trying to steep myself in the details of the product line, so bear with me, guys. We'll make sure I don't get too far afield. But at the end of the day, what the MBUS Pro did is it came in and it provided you an optic that had a much more rugged aspect to it, because it was made of metal. But between these first three generations of backup iron sights, there is one thing missing that to me was always very important. In all of my initial training with the platform, we were able to adjust for elevation using the rear sight. And with the Gen 1, Gen 2, and the Pro, that wasn't an option. And then Magpul came out with the MBUS Pro LR adjustable rear sight. And I think at that point, they really have fused all of the functionality that one was able to get out of a stock A2, and they've translated that functionality into what we see today most commonly on the market in terms of, you know, flat tops and sometimes a system or an upper that doesn't have a front sight base. And so we're talking about a mated iron sight on the front of your handguard. And the MBUS Pro, and adding an elevation adjustment, really kind of takes it into the next level. Now, it's not like your standard A2 upper, in that it's not a fully controllable adjustment, but it will take you to common distances. It is in many ways, I think, kind of like what some of the German diopter sights are like. It allows you to dial up, you know, 100, 200, 300, so forth. And that's a much better approach to using, I think, the optic, given the constraints of size and its, you know, folding features and the profile you want when it's, you know, laying on the rail. So it's not full functionality, but it is certainly a good deal more than one would have had with the first three choices. And, you know, at this point, I'm sure that Magpul has many things up their sleeve. We don't know of anything that's on the horizon. I think there might be something coming out. There's some people doing some things with the pricing on their Inbus Pros. And so, you know, that always kind of makes me feel like they're either clearing inventory for something they're being told is coming. But even at that, I think Magpul is pretty aggressive about letting people know what's in the lineup and what's on the horizon. And I haven't heard anything. Have you heard anything, JD, that makes it sound like Magpul's coming out with a new modification to their optic?
Just the sale on some of their stuff, but nothing concrete. I'm trying to search right now to see if I can find anything coming up, but nothing's really, if they do have something, they're keeping tight lips.
You know, I can't remember which show it was. It may have been three shows ago. We ran into the guys at Diamond Head USA. They make the Diamond Head sights. And, you know, I think that they make a really fine sight. But when we ran into them, what we were most impressed with was an optic that folded under an optic. I mean, a backup iron sight that folded up under an optic. And it was an offset. And so the way that they had structured the mounting of it, the optic slipped out the side and then up to be fully engaged, which allowed it to fold and tuck underneath a scope or, you know, a magnifier or whatever it was that was hanging off of your rail. And so when we saw that, it really kind of brought Diamond Head a little much more closely to my attention. And I got a set of these Diamond Head sights. And, you know, I really do think that this is another quality entry into the field of iron sights. And so that is one that I would definitely put on my list of worthy buys when it comes to an optic, or, I mean, a backup iron sight. I keep saying optic. I'm really beginning to muddy this discussion by doing that. So, listeners, if you hear me say optic, I'm just talking about an iron sight. I will be better as we continue. So, Diamond Head, I think, makes a pretty good product. And I've really been kind of impressed with that innovative spark. There are a lot of people that are in this aspect of the industry and this aspect of the AR-15 and its place in the firearms industry. They want to make the bits and pieces that go on the rail. They want to go make the bits and pieces that get integrated into a rifle, into somebody else's build, into a manufacturer's offering. And sometimes they don't innovate because they're just happy to fill, you know, carbon copy requests for the same old, same old. But, you know, Diamond Head seems to have really kind of spread their energies and come up with some creative ways to solve some very common problems. And, you know, I think in that vein, the next offering is something that really has, in me, created a great deal of interest. So that would be the micro optics that Knights Armament offers. They have a micro front flip sight and a micro 600 meter rear flip sight. Now the front flip sight is very similar in appearance and function to the Inbus Pro front sight. It has a mechanism that allows you to raise and lower your front sight post that is connected to basically a wheel that has a very strong tactile response or feedback sensation. And it's very rigid. It won't spin easily, but it is very much in the same vein as what the Magpul Embus Pro sight front sight does. That wheel allows you to raise or lower the front sight post. Instead of having to get a tool out, you can just do it with your thumb and forefinger. And so I think, to me, that's pretty nice to allow you to get in there and do that without having to pull out a front sight tool. The micro 600 meter rear flip sight, to me, is really the linchpin of why this is a good set of optics for your rifle. And what they've done is they've basically taken a post and set a peep on top of it. And that post has a cylinder which rotates around the post, and it allows you to rotate the cylinder, and by doing so, raising or lowering the peep. And so you now have something that has a very, very low profile that allows for elevation adjustments. Hmm. It also has a windage adjustment. So what you have here is a really high quality, full functional solution to the issue of how do I get elevation adjustments into a backup iron sight. And the barrel component, as far as I know, is not a new idea. I believe it may have been a Mauser. I think there were some old lever action guns that had this same kind of, or same style of rear sight on them. But of course, this is modernized. It's connected to a foundation that mates to your upper receiver's rail. And, you know, the durability and ruggedness of modern manufacturing has been put into its development, I'm sure, as well. So, but, you know, once again, to me, that critical component is the ability to have an elevation adjustment. And so that's kind of why I really like the Knights Armament matched set in terms of adding them to our list here for consideration. You know, the next one here is Yankee Hill Machine. And Yankee Hill Machine really is one of those companies that has always kind of been part and parcel to what has always been going on with the AR-15. I think they've been there from the beginning. They've always produced quality gear and equipment for the rifle. I've enjoyed everything that I've ever gotten from Yankee Hill Machine, and I've never been dissatisfied with anything. And you know, I think that's rare, because there are some companies that just, they can't do everything. The things they do well are great, but sometimes when they try to kind of step out of the niche they've carved for themselves, they don't do so great. But Yankee Hill Machine has always done really well with what they've put out there, as far as I'm concerned. And the QDS system is something that, to me, really kind of embodies, you know, the ruggedness, the durability, the quality of manufacturing that we find in the Yankee Hill products. And so, you know, it's definitely a straightforward front and rear sight set, but it does have all of the quality that Yankee Hill Machine is known for. I think the next one that really for my use is one of the better solutions out there. Troy Industries is the manufacturer, but it's a 45 degree offset sight. But the thing that I really like most about this setup is that Troy went to great lengths to engineer an ambidextrous set of offset sights. Their system will allow you to mount it for a lefty out of the box without extra parts or extra consideration. Yes, you do have to flip around some things, but that's nothing compared to some of the struggles the lefty has to go through to get something that'll meet a particular need. So I like the fact that that was engineered into their offering. But, you know, it comes with their standard quality Troy optics, or Troy iron sights. See, I said optics again. So the addition of that offset mount really makes this 45 degree offset sight set a truly quality addition, if that's what you're going for. But even in the absence of the offset component, their iron sights are still high quality, very durable, very well-made iron sights. You know, I think the next one is kind of what I like to harken back to when I'm feeling nostalgic. And it's the old AR-15 carry handle. Of course, when they came in with the flat top upper receivers, manufacturers developed a carry handle that was removable. And so it was, in essence, almost the same as having an A2 upper receiver. And so you had your fully integrated rear sight in the carry handle, and the carry handle mated to the rail on the upper receiver, and provided that it was within the required specifications and your front sight base was the proper front sight base, an F-marked front sight, then the two would work perfectly. And the one I got, because it had the most indicators of being the right dimensions, the right specification, that was the Bravo Company manufacturing AR-15 carry handle. You know, I think when it comes down to it, to me, this just takes me back to the days when I first learned to shoot the platform. This takes me back to that, the days of simplicity when you knew that the rifle that the armory had issued you was going to do exactly what your, dope book said it was going to do every time you took it out there. And, you know, part and parcel to that understanding of what the rifle was going to do was understanding how to utilize the rear sight. And, you know, of course, that was a long time ago. I've probably forgotten more about that than anything. But, you know, the carry handle is really a good rear iron sight for any rifle that has a front sight base. And I can't tell you enough that this is going to suit your needs. And, you know, I'm not going to lie to you. The offerings, other than the polymer that we've talked about throughout this whole thing, as a set, they're expensive. You're going to spend upwards of $200 for a set of these optics. You can get a good carry handle for $100. Now, of course, you don't have to buy a front sight because, well, you already got one. You got the A2 front sight base. And so you might look at me and say, well, that's still $100 for a rear sight, no matter how you slice it. Well, that may be, but at least it's not a set, right? So, you know, another, I guess, another iron sight choice that adjusts for elevation is one from a company called iTac Defense. It's a rotary diopter rear sight. And, you know, if you've ever been handsy with any of the HK rifles or subguns, then you probably know what a diopter sight looks like. It's hard to explain it, and so I'm not even going to do you the injustice of having me try to describe it. But the one I have is actually made by iTac for 6 hour, and so it's on some of the 6 hour rifles. And I think if you search iTac Defense diopter, you'll find plenty of pictures on Google. The sighting system is unique. It's not hard. It's very intuitive. And the ability to actually change elevation is, I think, uniquely approached. And I have it here. It's on a LaRue mount for a EATEC, so no hate mail, guys. And there it is. There's the diopter. And so if you are going to look at our YouTube video, you will now see me holding this optic up. And, you know, there's just kind of a barrel that you're looking through. And that barrel has a place where you're going to mate your front sight post with your rear sight picture. And the two just kind of naturally go together very easily. But, you know, once again, it answers the need that I've developed for myself of wanting to adjust for elevation. And it does it in a unique way. So I think that's something that you can still find, I believe, on eBay. You may be able to find it on GunBroker. I'm not really all that certain that they're readily available these days, but I think there may be some out there.
Would you hold that up against again on the camera? I'm going to take a screenshot and so we can post it in the show notes. All right, there we go. Give me a side view of it real quick. There, that's perfect. There, we'll include those of that in the show notes for everyone.
All right. So we've got all of the Facebook and the non-Facebook listeners addressed here as far as their needs go. So the last one I have in my list is probably one of the very first rear sights I ever acquired. And that is an LMT L8A tactical adjustable rear sight. Now, the thing that I like about this particular offering is that it once again has an adjustment for elevation. The thing that I don't like is that this is not in any way a sexy rear optic. This doesn't fold, it doesn't get out of the way. It is a big, giant, clunky fin on the rear of your upper receiver. You know, imagine you had one of those removable carry handles, but you just cut the carry handle part off. That's what it would be. But needless to say, it still is a quality choice when it comes to the issue of trying to get something that's going to help you in the iron sight department. So I think that I've covered a fairly broad spectrum of choices. These are ones that I've personally been able to use, that I've personally had comfort with and success with, and that I would spend my money on again. And I think that it's a wide enough selection of choices to where you're not going to feel like you're hemmed in terms of limited options. But, you know, the unfortunate thing is, and this is going to always be the case with things that are critical, but quality is important. They carry a price tag that is sometimes unpalatable. You're going to spend as much for a set of these iron sights as you would for a barrel. And they're not an optic. They're not a piece of glass. They're not going to give you some, you know, prismatic dot or some holographic dot or, you know, any of the other ways of providing a optic to you. They're not going to do that. And so you may not want to include them in your build. I am always of that opinion that the optic can and will fail you at the worst possible time. And if you don't have a way to get in there and do what you need to in terms of the actual utility of using that rifle, you have a paperweight. Mm-hmm. So my money is always going to go first, making sure that I have a dependable baseline way of sighting my rifle, a way of aiming and delivering my fire in exactly the way I want to. And so this for me is that way. So in all of that, JD, what would you think are some of the primary considerations when we're looking at backup iron sights?
I mean, for me, it's the quality. And I was looking at the Knights Armament ones as you were doing it. And I know it's a, I pieced them together. It'd be about, I think, $300 for the set. But still, you know, it proves true what you said, because I have a EOTech on top of my Daniel defense rifle, took it out, tried to power up the EOTech, batteries are dead, and of course, forgot batteries. And so thankfully, I have iron sights that are on the rifle, so I was able to still enjoy it and shoot it. But I don't, the new SBR build I have, a couple other rifles, I just kind of swap back and forth some optics, and maybe it's time to join the big boys and actually put some backup iron sights on them, or have them available so I can enjoy shooting those without having to move the optics around. I guess is one of the things I always thought I needed, maybe an EOTech or an Aimpoint or even an ACOG, but hey, you can still have fun. It's still enjoy the rifle with backup sights and even have less money. I mean, an ACOG is going to run you, what, $1,000? Yeah. And you can get a good set of these for a lot cheaper than that.
Yeah, and you know, I think there is something to be said for the idea that if you're going to integrate both an optic and irons into a build, paying that first tranche for backup irons puts the rifle, you know, in the game for you. And if you have to delay, either because you're laying away or saving up or you're waiting for the opportune moment, if you have to delay the purchase of that optic for any reason, you still have the full use and enjoyment of the rifle until such time as you get your $1,000 optic. So to me, I think that there is some economy in that. I kind of think that it is hard to justify having a rifle that's going to sit in your safe for, I don't know, your next tax refund, because you're waiting for the money to get a nice optic, or you're going to put it on layaway and you've got some, you know, 6, 7, 8, 9 month plan to get, you know, what can be a pretty large chunk of change paid out to your vendor before you actually get hands on it. So, you know, it makes your rifle kind of a silly appendage. You might as well have bought your optic first and then figured out how to get your rifle
built around it. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I really am always going to fall on that side of the argument. You know, I think really when it comes to considerations for backup iron sights, you really have to put some thought into how else are you going to dress your rifle. You know, if you throw an optic on your rifle, and I mean an optic in the truest sense now, you have to figure out whether you have to fit your irons in their folded position underneath the optic. You need to figure out if they're not going to be underneath. Are they in a position where the iron can be deployed? Are you going to have to choose a mount that will allow for whatever you have on the rifle, like an offset set of optics? Are offset optics going to really be of some value to you in the ways that you want to shoot the rifle? You know, offsets are great if you're a three gunner and you anticipate engaging at 300 yards and then, you know, flipping the rifle on its side and engaging at 75. It kind of makes very little sense if that's not your utility, if the only reason that the optic or the backup iron sight is there is in case something catastrophic happens to your optic, in which case, why would you have the optic on top of your rifle anyway? You probably take it off and just switch to your irons. Well, now, if you have offset irons, everything has to be done at a cant. And, you know, so, I mean, I really think that you have to consider how you're going to dress your rifle before you can decide on a choice of which optic you're going to get. AD, other thoughts?
I just think it kind of opened up my eyes to what, you know, being the rookie here and maybe not thinking the backup irons were that important, but even running through my own experience of that EOTech dying, you know, that would have taken that rifle completely out of the you know, rotation to be able to shoot productively. So maybe I need to adopt a little bit of Reed's enthusiasm for iron sights, maybe not to full extent, but there's great ways. The Magpul ones we talked about are easy to get into. There's the others, the Knight's Armament really intrigue me for the SBR build I have to be able to play around a little bit. I guess I always thought it was the optic first, the EOTech, the aimpoint, the ACOG, the Vortex, something like that first, and then I'd add the irons later. But what you made said makes complete sense, that rifle's good to go right from the start if you, in your budget, in your build, you just add the iron sights in there. So it's ready to go from day one. As soon as you've got everything ready to go, you got the irons on top, you can go take it out and shooting. And I cannot stand having a rifle done, not being able to go out and shoot it productively. So I think it's going to change a little bit how I do future builds to make sure it's one of the items that I build before or buy before the gun's complete. Maybe even expand my collection of iron sights from one set to two or three.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I would say another consideration is that you want to think about what your optic or your iron sight is doing for you and your understanding of how to use it. You know, when you look at the LMT or the BCM carry handle, they use the traditional A2 rear sight, and all of the components of that are integrated into those two choices. And so to understand, you know, how many clicks is going to elevate your rifle to the right, your sight to the right point where you can hit at 300 and then at 500 or 200 is important, but it's not something that is intuitive. It doesn't just, you know, there's no, well, if you're shooting, you know, this distance on this day with this ammunition, click it here. That's not part of your instruction set. So you have to become familiar with the sight. You know, at the same time, you know, if you were going to use like the old Imbus Pro or Imbus Gen 2 or, you know, any of the other backup irons that don't have an adjustment for elevation, mm-hmm. you're going to have to really decide for yourself, you know, A, how am I going to formulate my sight picture? You know, am I going to, you know, cut my target in half? Am I going to do a 6 o'clock hold? Am I going to do something else unique or off the wall? Whatever it is that you're going to do, you're going to have to figure out what that is, integrate it into your understanding of that rifle, and then sight your rifle in with that understanding and play. And so it is only through having a repeatable baseline that you're going to make that iron sight work for you. You have to understand what it is going to do every time you use it. And so I do think that you need to understand that there is a learning curve and you need to incorporate whatever efforts you know you need to incorporate to get that learning curve under your belt. So I would say that's probably my last consideration. AD, do you have any considerations or final thoughts on this aspect of it?
No, I think I'm just going to dive into the ones you listed here and see which ones work for me and maybe try to focus on shooting with iron sights a little bit more this summer. Then using optics to see if I can become proficient with those, and then move back to optics.
Well, I have to tell you that, you know, I don't know if I'm bragging on myself or not, but we went out there and we shot our rangefinder and found a good 100-yard track, and or no, 150-yard track, and set up a 12-inch AR-500 steel target. And I got out the M1 Garand, and the M1 Garand has a pretty traditional rear peep, front post, and just started dinging steel at 150 yards. And I had followed the field manual for the M1, and this was like a circa 1948 field manual obtained on the internet, like all great pieces of information these days. And I was able to zero the rifle at the range and then use my understanding of that rear sight to dial in to my 150-yard point and just ding steel. But, you know, 12 inches at 150 yards is a very small piece of real estate. And that iron sight got me there every time.
Nice.
So the rifle itself, that M1 Garand, is not really designed to have any kind of optic on it. You know, the Model D aside in terms of the sniper rifle. But if you're just going to get whatever the CMP is going to hand off the rack in terms of a special grade rifle, no, it's not going to have any allowance for an optic of any sort. So, you know, my understanding of irons led me to be able to shoot that rifle with a, I think, a very comfortable high degree of accuracy. And so I am never going to not tell you that it's not important to understand how to use those irons. So let's just touch on zeroing your sights. I know that we've had a show where we talked about it in depth. We may have even had two. You know, zeroing your sights is really always a matter of personal preference. There are a number of different methodologies in terms of distance, in terms of, you know, objective, and in terms of the mechanics. And so I'm not going to belabor that issue. Everybody has their own opinion. Everybody has their own comfort level. But really, when it comes down to it, I think you need to decide for yourself how you're going to do it. What is your methodology? What is the thing that you are going to strive for? Because if you don't essentially come up with one way of doing it every time, you will probably never know how to shoot any of your rifles unless you keep copious notes or you just have an incredibly gifted memory. So, you know, I think it makes sense to just pick a system, zero your rifle, and zero every rifle after that the same way. And, you know, I think it goes even further in terms of pick your hold, pick your sight picture, pick the things that are going to be repeatable for you because that's the way you always do it, and use that as the foundation for zeroing every rifle, for using every backup iron sight. When it's time to put them into play, make sure that whatever that is, whatever you have decided upon, whatever you are trained to do, is what you rely on and fall back on every time. There just is so many options in terms of the assistance, the backup iron sights that are available. There's so many different types of rifles, and there's so many different ways of putting them all together. If you don't draw a line in the sand and say, this is what I do every time, you know, you're just going to get frustrated with your rifles. And I think also, if you can set up a rifle to do a thing that way, one way, the way that you decide, that is also how you're going to be able to instruct someone else on how to use your rifle. You know, I'm sure that if you step in and someone's going to cut the target in half, but you're using a 6 o'clock hold, they may be shooting high on a target that's 12 inches round. Who knows? But I think consistency and drawing that line in the sand is your most important part of zeroing your sights. Figure out the range, the method, the sight picture, all these other factors, and incorporate it into the way you use that rifle every time, and every rifle every time. So I think that's all I have to say on that. Any thoughts?
A lot of information to digest, and maybe I won't give you such a hard time about iron sights in the future.
Oh, you know you will. Everybody loves to give me a hard time about iron sights. But mark my words, everybody has that day where something fails and they're like, crap, that old bastard is right. All right. So having come back from a nice successful range day, and by successful, I mean everybody had a good time. Everybody came back with all their digits. Nobody had any extra holes they didn't want. So what goes into a successful range day? So, JD, I understand that ranges out near you are a little more free form, right? You just go pick a empty piece of BLM land that doesn't have any ranchers on it and just go to town, right?
Yeah, we avoid the Bundys and we find areas that are about, I think it's 1,000 yards off the, or 1,000 feet off the blacktop. So there's plenty of area. So it's a nice wide open west you're shooting into. You look for a hill that would be a good berm, an area you got a good backstop. And a lot of times it's, you'll see trucks pull off the highway at different random spots. You'll see a couple tarps or maybe a table or something in the back of the truck. You know exactly what they're going out to do. And it's fun to have the freedom to go do that. It's not, range officers and safety officers are great, but sometimes it's just nice to go out and shoot with you and a couple friends and not have to put weapons down or listen to commands, and you guys can just hang out and kind of have a good time, safe time, but a good time too.
We know living in our area, there aren't very many rural areas that have that kind of freedom. So, you know, we go to ranges inside the city. 100 yards is probably about the max you can get. And, you know, most of them are bounded by developments of one sort or another. The accommodations they've made for safety are pretty standard, pretty straightforward, nothing too out of the ordinary. But there is a bit of a restriction in terms of what you feel you can do and certainly what the rules allow you to do. So I'm more partial to finding land that's a little more open, a little more or less restricted, and that usually ends up being because you know somebody that has a piece of land somewhere. We were fortunate to have been invited to a property, and the host invited us for the sole purpose of having a bunch of guys out to have a day of shooting and fun. And so it really was very enjoyable to be in a place where we had the freedom to really kind of, like you said, in a safe way, do what we wanted to do in terms of our shooting plan, our shooting day. So I think really one of the first things that one has to think about when you're trying to figure out how to have a successful range day is, you know, it's the old real estate adage. It's location, location, location. So you use public BLM land to set up a safe range day. And me, I like rural land because, of course, you know, Governor Abbott here told the BLM to stay the hell out of Texas. But so that's I think the first important part of a successful range day. And you know, I don't think that the old school stagnant outdoor range is going to stay that way for very long. We of course have an indoor range here that has a lot of nice options, but I think that there are more and more ranges coming up where people have put some thought and time into considering what the shooters want. Mm-hmm. You know? And so, you know, instead of having a client base that is essentially your once a year sight in the deer rifle segment and the segment that just bought a pistol segment. They're looking to put on training classes and they want to put on seminars and workshops. And to do that, they need to have ranges that allow people to do things like shoot and move or give people choices in what they're shooting at or allow people to draw from the hip. And so I think there is going to slowly be a transition in many of these kind of more static ranges into something that's a little more active. Although I haven't seen it quite at that level yet. I think it's where it's going to go. I think for me, it's a hard lesson learned. The next important thing is remember to wear sunscreen. A little toasty spot on the back of my noggin here where it's not quite as thick as it was when I was young. But sunscreen is important. Make sure that you you get some sunscreen. Bug spray is also nice to have if you're in the country. I don't know. Do you guys have mosquitoes out there in the dry desert?
What are those?
Bugs, insects? No, I mean, no. You guys have scorpions, but there's not really a scorpion repellent, is there?
Yeah, your boot.
You know, I have to tell you, kind of the third part here is something that, you know, I'll tell you that I'm guilty of not doing all the time. And my last, this last weekend, I had a series of events walking out the door that illustrated to me the necessity. The reality is you're going to forget something. So make a list. You know, I walked out the door and, I forgot my phones. And so I came back to get my phones and I realized that I hadn't packed my bag. And so I had no clothes to wear. If I hadn't come back for my phones, I would have no clothes to wear for the next day, you know? So at that point I had to slow down and just kind of think through what I'd packed and figure out if there was anything I'd forgotten. And by and large, I did fairly well. But, you know, I did forget a few things. So make a list. I think it's important to make a list to make sure that you have everything. Nothing like getting out to the range and realizing you didn't bring any magazines or you didn't bring any ammo for that particular caliber.
Pistol ammo.
Yeah.
All your pistols.
You needed a tool, you know, a torque wrench or a bit or something, and it's not with you. And those are the times that you get the most frustrated because something that you had planned and anticipated on shooting is now irrelevant to what you brought out because it's just a paperweight. A rifle without ammo, a rifle without a mechanism to feed your ammo, a rifle that is coming loose or whatever the case may be. These are all things that really irritate me. So, you know, I do think it's important to make that list and make sure you're thorough. You know, I think one of the things that is important, the next one on the list, is for you to keep yourself flexible. Think outside the box. There are sometimes you're going to have to come up with some field expedient solutions, and they may not be obvious. I had a busy Friday. I was thinking to myself that I'd take out some bowling pins to shoot, and then I reconsidered and I thought, well, you know what, steel would probably be really nice, but you know, where are you going to find a steel plate, you know, at, you know, 10 o'clock in the afternoon when you have to be headed out pretty quickly and your day's full? I used the internet, I sourced a location. They didn't have what I did want in stock, but they had something that was perfect that I didn't know they had. And so it was just a 12-inch round with a couple of, I guess, ears that they had straps hanging in. And so I could hang this steel from those straps from a crossbar, and there you go. I have a steel target. And, nice. You know, I had them courier it where I needed it. And so what would have probably taken me 2 hours that I didn't have in terms of round trip, I got a courier to take care of for me. So sometimes you just have to think out of the box to get something taken care of. And so I don't know how you invoke thinking out of the box, either you are capable or you're not. But I guess I'm an out of the box thinker. And then, you know, of course, we had to get out into the field and figure out a way to hang that steel. And we got some T posts and some baling wire, and we were able to put it all together, and it worked just fine. So, heck, I'd say don't be afraid to think out of the box.
I put the next one up there because if I get out there and even if I have everything I need to shoot and I get hungry, I'm still grumpy. So, in the middle of the desert, especially when our temperatures reach 115, 120 in the summertime, you got to take water and snacks, you know, make it an enjoyable experience. Don't get hangry. Don't turn into Betty White that needs a Snickers. Make sure you're enjoying your time out there shooting. It's supposed to be a way to relieve stress. And, you know, I always kind of pack to make sure if something happens, if I go into a rough area and my truck breaks down or something, I'm going to be okay for a while I'm waiting for people to come get me out. So I have food in the truck, but, always make sure you pack enough water, especially with summertime coming, springtime coming. For us, it's one of the necessities. If you don't take water out in the range, it's going to be a pretty miserable experience here.
Well, you know, and I think we ran into that. Our host pointed out that by the time we got out and set up and everything unpacked and our safety briefing done, it was going to be lunch anyway. So why don't we just bring lunch with us? And so, you know, he threw in a loaf of bread, lunch meat, and, you know, the trimmings, and, you know, we had a sandwich when it was time. Because, you know, who wants to pack it all up and take it back in for lunch? Yeah. So I think definitely water and snacks, you know, those are some good elements to what you need to take out there. So I see you threw out first aid kit, and that's one of the things that really to me is I think it's critically important that you acknowledge the reality of what it is we're doing, and the fact that someone can get hurt, and maybe not even directly because of what you're doing, but, you know, because, you know, you're out, you know, on somebody's, you know, empty acreage, or because you're out in the desert or whatever. But, you know, we are shooting firearms, and firearms can, you know, people can get hurt. A moment of carelessness can, you know, result in a situation where we need to bring out the first aid kit and, you know, do some trauma care. Mm-hmm. So, and I carry a first aid kit that, I wouldn't say that it is what the military issued, not by any stretch of the imagination, but, you know, knowing a couple of, flight medics in the Army, you know, I've been given a thorough briefing of what ought to be in a handy kit. So I've got the tourniquets, the clotting material, the pressure dressings, the just all the normal run-of-the-mill stuff. And so it's not so much I have a headache or I, you know, put a, you know, splinter in my finger because I'm a special snowflake kind of stuff. You know, it's the, you know, I just, you know, stepped on a punchy stick or, you know, somebody, you know, put a bullet in my rear end, whatever the case may be. JD, do you have any thoughts on what's important for you in a first aid kit? I know you have a little bit of a different environment form than I do.
You know, just making sure I have the right stuff to handle basically anything light that comes to mind. I mean, if it's heavy duty, thankfully the highway in the hospital is not that far down the road, and you still get cell service out there. I think one of the most important things to take in a medical kit is actually somebody else who can drive. That's probably, maybe you can't fit them in a kit, but that's kind of one of the rules that I have. My wife kind of instituted it, that if something happens to one of us, the other person can grab and go and throw somebody in a truck, in a car, and, you know, be able to call 911 and have the ambulance meet them on the highway. but dressings for in case, you know, in case there's a bullet wound, anything above that, I'm not really qualified to take care of, but I can stop bleeding. I can hold pressure. I can try to comfort and stop shock to set in case something really bad happens. So, I guess mine is to make sure you take somebody with you that can drive. I don't go shooting alone. So it's not really a kit, more of a philosophy that helps with that kit.
Well, so I would say that the next thing to consider are targets. You know, when it comes down to a day at the range, I think the objective is that you're going to shoot at something. And so a consideration of what kind of targets you're going to take with you is very important. You know, a piece of steel that you can hang from scrap costs $55. You know, I've probably ordered $55 worth of paper targets that, you know, seldom get used. And when you do throw them up on whatever improvised backing you come up with out in, you know, some rural area, they're not going to last very long because of the wind or other conditions. So, you know, I'm really kind of headed towards the idea that the steel targets are the way to go. Mm-hmm. And as was illustrated, every time I've shot on steel and by many of the people that we shot with this last weekend, there is nothing like the visceral reaction one has to the feedback of that steel dinging to kind of give you a sense of what you're doing, where you are in terms of your shooting and your performance. Having steel ding at you is just really, really nice feedback.
It definitely, I think watching the video where you guys are, I believe Steve was shooting and you were offering your advice and your support and your cheerleading skills. Just hearing it ding, you know, that I don't have any steel targets. We generally shoot paper or wood targets or something like that. So that instant feedback, even just watching the video, is like, I got to get one of those because that'll keep me just shooting over and over, like the mouse ringing the bell over and over and over to get the cheese. I mean, there's no cheese involved, but you get that instantaneous feedback that, hey, guess what? You hit it with your iron sights.
Now, in terms of other targets, of course, you know, everything's, you know, fair game. I know that if we watch Hickok 45's videos, he gets out there and he'll throw some old soda bottles up on a string and what else? Of course, he shoots a lot of steel, but clay pots, those are always nice to shoot. There's just an enormous number of options, and I don't think that you should limit yourself in any way. Of course, we want to be safe. We want to make sure that we're allowing for the proper setup of a target. For instance, the steel target we shot was angled in the shop in a way that you could hang it and it would deflect an impacted projectile downwards toward the ground instead of outwards back at you. So, you know, do be careful about your choice in targets and put some thought there, but I'd say sky's the limit. Be creative, whatever you want to do.
Okay. Also, in this area, since it's so rural and people go out all over the place when your targets and you're shooting stuff, even if you bring stuff like steel and things out there, grab a few garbage bags and keep them with you. Cause unfortunately some of the greatest sites that we have to shoot at here in Southern Nevada are beautiful sites are now littered with a bunch of garbage. So we try to pack when we go shooting, we try to pack a bunch of stuff out, you know, that we didn't bring, but it's still, I mean, it's land everybody gets to share. And unfortunately we got idiots that like to take TVs and refrigerators and mattresses, mm-hmm. You name it. It's just, it's unfortunate. Thankfully I found a couple new spots where a little harder to get in. So those areas tend to be avoided by those that are just looking for a quick dump or looking to shoot something like a microwave or something.
Right. Well, I think that's a good approach. And really, we have to take care of the things that we enjoy or people are not going to have us back, right?
Absolutely.
So, you know, I think in terms of having a day at the range, you want to put some variety into your shooting. You know, we brought out a clay thrower and got out some shotguns and spent enough time shooting clays to bruise up our shoulders. But, you know, you can only shoot, you know, precision rifle for so long before you have to move on to something else. At one of our range days years ago, we took a playing cards, stapled them to a board, and the objective was to shoot 21. And so we played blackjack. There are just a number of things you can do to make your shooting experience more interesting and give you enough things to do so that nobody gets bored. And, you know, I think that's the important part of having a fun day at the range, that you don't shoot just long enough to be bored. And then everybody else is still having fun while you're wanting to go. So I think variety is the key there. I think that there's certainly one thing to consider in terms of a day at the range. And that is that you're going to be fatigued. And if you are there for a particular reason, just want to shoot in the latest build, you are interested in trying your hand at some particular feat with a rifle that you are familiar with, whatever it is, you know, you're gonna tire yourself out, you know, halfway through a day of good solid full shooting. And so I'd say if you have some objectives, get them out of the way. You know, there's a fellow that came with us. He wanted to sight in a 30-06, and he took it out there. And, you know, by the time that we had shot all these other things and he had cracked open his gun case for the 30-06, he was so tired that some of his fundamentals were, you know, beginning to escape him, and he couldn't get consistent hits. And if you can't get consistent hits, you can't sight in a rifle. So I think it would have suited him better if we'd have started very first thing. He'd gotten out his rifle, we'd taken some hits. He'd figured out where he needed to be while he was still fresh and still, you know, had plenty of energy. So, you know, I think you need to consider, you know, what it is you're doing and what toll it's going to take on you, because, you know, nobody's having fun if, you know, you're just worn out and not shooting well and not in a position to enjoy what you're doing. So, what's this last one here, JD?
Well, you see kind of I posted one, I think it was last week. You see the videos of people going out shooting, and I know that this is probably not our crowd, but if you ever see it, make sure you step in before something bad happens. Don't be a jerk, or don't let somebody be a jerk. Don't put a firearm in somebody's hands that is too powerful for them, or they don't understand what's going to happen to where they get hurt. I shared a video last week of a guy giving a hunting rifle to a girl, and she got scoped and she's bleeding profusely from right above her eye. She's probably going to be scared to death of the rifle or any kind of shooting for the rest of her life. It's not funny. No. I mean, it's dumb, and man, you should get smacked if you do something like that, because you're putting a powerful weapon in somebody's hands. You want them to enjoy it. You want them to continue to do it and maybe catch on to the hobby themselves, not, you know, get scarred or hurt and you're sitting there snickering because you got a YouTube video that might get 100,000 likes. Well, if it gets 100,000 likes, you're still going to be a jerk after that video is long gone. Yeah, and
that's 100,000 people that are jerks liking someone getting hurt.
And so. It's just not, it's one of those things, like, we have enough negativity in coming at us from the outside enough people that are looking for excuses to ban things or to call for this capacity to be leveled or whatever. We on the inside need to take care of those that are interested in shooting. Like if you start that gal out, the video that we posted on our Facebook page, if you start that gal out with a 5.56 or a 22 or something like that, that she can manage, she's probably going to enjoy shooting a whole heck of a lot more than she did when whatever caliber of that rifle came back and just about knocked her out. So that's what I mean by not being a jerk. I mean, we enjoy this hobby. I know you guys enjoy this hobby too. We want it to spread. We want it to thrive. We want it to be impossible to stop because of the people that enjoy it. And one way we can do that is to not be jerks. And if we see it, I've seen it before, and you can step in. I mean, it's all about safety. That's a safety thing. You step in, you're in the right 100% if somebody's putting a weapon in somebody's hands that has no business holding it because they don't have the experience.
Right. Well, you know, I think that that kind of highlights one of the things that was a part of our weekend. We had two shooters that were not very prolific shooters, hadn't spent a whole lot of time on the trigger of many of the things that we brought. And, you know, when you can create a safe environment for someone to learn, when you can create an environment that is conducive to learning and invites people who don't know those things to learn, you're going to make a lifelong fan of the sport.
Absolutely. And
I don't think you can ever go wrong with being inclusive and being helpful and, you know, going the extra mile to make sure that whoever is going to be with you has a good time. So, I mean, I would wholeheartedly agree with the don't be a jerk aspect. And then, you know, I think really kind of one last point that I think is worth bringing up. You know, I think safety is sometimes taken for granted. And we shoot, we do a safety briefing. We have a thorough understanding before we even begin of who's coming out with what expertise, what experience, what knowledge. We make sure that we are covering all of the rules that a safe shooter needs to incorporate into their day. And then we make it clear to everybody that everybody is in charge of safety. If you're not a prolific shooter, if you're a beginning shooter, you have just as much authority, just as much of an imperative to step up and say, hey, wait a minute, this guy said that was unsafe. You know, we need to call a ceasefire, or please don't do that, or, you know, hey, everybody, what's going on here? You know, I thought, you know, you have to participate. And so safety is a primary concern. And I think that we as experienced shooters don't always make that a part of what we do in an overt way. I mean, I go to a public range, I wait for them to call ceasefire, I put up my targets, I wait for them to call the range hot, I throw my guns up on the bench, I load them up, I start shooting. I don't sit back and have myself a safety briefing with myself. You know, I don't make sure that I'm going to follow some rigid set of rules every time I do that. You know, I'm going to follow the range's rules. And I'll lock my bolt back and empty the mag well and make sure all those things are done right. But I don't go the extra mile. And I think that if you're going to have a successful range day with a group, you have to go the extra mile, because we are all responsible for making sure everybody walks off that range.
Absolutely.
With all their digits and with no extra holes.
I absolutely agree.
All right. Now, of course, there were some other considerations of what needs to go into a successful range day. So why don't you talk about what some of the listeners wrote into us about?
Okay, so we asked you guys on Facebook, and you made us laugh. Honorable mentions to make the list on what makes a successful range day. Chad Wallace said yoga pants. Chad, I know you plan on going to SHOT Show 2017. You will not be allowed to wear yoga pants to my house. Tim, I said cowboy boots, crotchless chaps. That's got to be an interesting range day with Tim. Jim said target girls in bikinis with fur hats and combat boots. Tip of the hat to you there, Jim. I'll stick to going with my friends. Andrew Smith, ammo, firearms, and a stapler. So a little bit more practical there on our honorable mention list for the what would make a successful range day. Let me go see if we got any more over here real quick. But thank you guys for your feedback and your interaction over on Facebook and on Instagram. Adds to the show, adds to the experience of the AR-15 podcast. Let's see here. We'll read through a couple of these. Chad also said a big gun, protection equipment. Jim said a couple of revolvers, steel targets, and my daughters always make it more enjoyable. John Allen went the tactical route. He says a tactical shooting sock, tactical shooting mat, tactical stapler. Jody keeping it basic, guns, ammo, and a timer. Daniel with eye protection, ear protection, first aid kit. Josh James said JW and multi-cam and Skittles. So shooting some camo and Skittles with JW sounds like an interesting range day. Rick said ammo, weapons, and target. Jody said someone to hold the target, someone to pick up my brass in a porta potty. great stuff over there, guys. Thank you for interacting over at the Facebook page.
Well, this week we have a shortage of feedback. I think in large part it's because we've had some transitions here at the podcast. So I'm not going to feel slighted in any way, but we want to remind you once again that we have a new feedback email address. So if you sent any feedback to us, prior to the 21st, I think it was, send it again. If it came in on the old email address, it did not make it to us. So with that, I think we'll forego feedback this week. And JD, I'll let you read us out.
All right. Once again, you can send questions or comments to ar15.podcast@gmail.com. You can also, let me double check real quick. I'm not sure if the SpeakPipe plugin is up on the new website. I'll double check that. But you can go to ar15podcast.com and check that out. Subscribe and listen to the podcast for free on iTunes or Stitcher and leave us a review so the show can place higher for potential listeners. Also, you can listen via the Pocket Casts app or the Downcast app. You can get those at the Apple iTunes store or be like Nick and say Stitcher works. Go Team Android. You can check us out on Instagram at AR15 Podcast. Tag your pictures with the AR15 Podcast. We'd love to repost those and share those. The YouTube page, you can catch this episode and others at youtube.com/c/AR15podcast. A lot of interaction over on Facebook, facebook.com/AR15podcast. Make sure you check out the other great podcasts on the Firearms Radio Networks. Also use the Brownells affiliate link for all your AR-15 parts at ar15podcast.com/parts. The Amazon affiliate links and that are at firearmsradio.tv also. And that wraps it up for this week. Also, remember, there are pretty cool giveaway coming up here that we'll be doing the spring to the early summer, it looks like. Going to be that pistol caliber that everybody's been asking about. So we can't wait to share that with you once we get things all finalized and set to go on that.
Well, in that case, folks, have a good week. We'll see you once again. See if we can't do this all over with something new and interesting. And as always, we appreciate every one of you and all the support you give us. Have a good night.
Take care.
This has been a production of the Firearms Radio Network. You can find more information at firearmsradio.tv.